Sing a new song to him who sits on heaven's mercy seat. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Holy, holy is he. Sing a new song to him who sits on heaven's mercy seat. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you. Clothed in rainbows of living color, flashes of lightning, rolls of thunder. Blessing and honor, strength and glory and power be to you, the only wise King. Yeah. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was with all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you. Filled with wonder, awestruck wonder at the mention of your name. Jesus, your name is power, breath and living water, such a marvelous mystery. Holy, holy, was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you.
Well, good morning. Welcome to First United Methodist. I am Keith Fessel. I'm one of the pastors here on staff. It is so good to be in worship with you this morning. Thank you so much, Amy Strother, for leading us in worship this morning. Isn't she wonderful?
Thanks for having me.
I am in such awe of you as mom, as artist, and how you bring God works through you. I'm just so pleased to have you in worship with us here today. If you are a guest this morning, special word of welcome to you. It is so glad that you are here. If you're here with us in the sanctuary, or if you're watching on television, or if you're watching us streaming on the internet, just so glad that you can be with us today. And whatever brought you here, in whatever form, I hope that you feel the Holy Spirit moving in your prayers and in your needs and in your joys. But for now, let us all stand up as we're able. Find someone you do not know this morning and pass the peace of Jesus Christ. Thank you.
To face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away, washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna, you are the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises. Face a day, and in your presence, all our fears are washed away, washed away. The day in your presence, all our fears are washed away. When we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away, washed away. Come have your way among us. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. To see you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing holy, holy, holy. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. To see you, I want to see you, see you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing holy, holy, holy. High and lifted up, shining glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing holy, holy, holy. High lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing. To see you. Holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. See you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing holy. To see you. Let the glory of the Lord rise among us. Let the glory of the Lord among us. Let the praises of the King rise among us, and let it rise. Let the songs of the Lord rise among us. Let the songs of the Lord rise among us. Let the joy of the King rise among us, and let it rise. the glory of the Lord rise among us. Let the praises of the King rise among us. Let it rise. And let the songs of the Lord rise among us. Let the songs of the Lord rise among us. Joy of the King rise among us. And let it rise. The glory of the Lord rise among us. Let the praises of the King rise among us. Let it rise.
You may be seated as we all join together and go to God in prayer. Today we stand at the gates of our Jerusalem. We wave our branches high on this Palm Sunday. Dear God, sometimes we get caught up in the excitement of the parade while Jesus sits astride on the donkey, a beast of burden bearing a most precious gift. We ask that you let the joy fill our hearts. Let us rise, dear God, this day. Let us rise and shout our hosannas. We praise you, God, for the wondrous ways in which our lives have been touched. We ask you today to prepare our hearts to worship and to celebrate this day as we enter into our Holy Week. We lift all things up to you today, dear God, our joys, our concerns, our failings, things that weigh us down, the things that lift us up. All these are part of our lives and part of our lives with you as we pray that prayer that Jesus taught us praying. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Well, we get to celebrate one of the two sacraments of the United Methodist Church today. And today it's going to be the sacrament of holy baptism. We invite Randy and Megan and their daughter Emery up to be part of that wonderful celebration. It is indeed an honor to be part of celebrating in that sacrament. Yay, family. It has to be in the top two to three things that we ever do as pastors, is to celebrate the gifts of baptism.
Thank you, pastors. Right there, perfect. Thank you.
Good morning. As Keith just shared, in the United Methodist Church, there are two special moments that we call sacraments. And we call them sacraments because we believe they're not just any ordinary moment, right? They're holy moments when it seems like the wall between heaven and earth kind of gets really thin, wears really thin, and we can experience God's love, God's grace in really physical stuff, like in communion, the bread and the cup, and like in baptism, this water. This is a holy moment for Emery. And for Randy and for Megan, it's a moment when heaven draws very near and we celebrate God's love in a way in this water of baptism. And you have a role in the service today too, and Randy and Megan do, and we all have a role in supporting and celebrating this holy day for Emory. Keith will begin.
Brothers and sisters in Christ, it is through the sacrament of holy baptism that we are initiated into Christ's holy church. We are incorporated into God's mighty acts of salvation, and we are given new birth through the water and the Spirit. All of this is God's gift, offered to us without a price. I ask both of you on behalf of the whole church, do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sins? If so, you would say, I do. Do you accept the freedom and power God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves? If so, you would say, I do. And you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior, put your whole church, trust. She doesn't want it, Daniel. You confess Jesus Christ as your Savior. Put your whole trust in His grace and promise to serve Him as your Lord in union with the whole church, with Christ as open to people of all ages, nations, and great races. If so, you would say, I do.
And then finally, will you nurture Emory in Christ's holy church that by your teaching and by your example, she may be guided to accept God's grace for herself, to profess her faith openly, and to lead a Christian life, if you will? Please say, I will. Friends, you have some promises to make as well. Do you, as Christ's body, the church, reaffirm both your rejection of sin and your commitment to Christ? If you do, church, please say, we do.
I do.
And will you nurture one another in the Christian faith and life, and include Emory, who is now before you? Your response is on the screen. With God's help.
We will proclaim the good news and live according to the example of Christ. We will surround Emory with a community of love and forgiveness that she may grow in her trust of God
and be found
faithful in service to others. We will pray for Emory that she may be a disciple who walks in the way that leads to life.
I invite you to please join with me in a moment of prayer. As we pray for God's blessings upon this water, and upon Emory, let's pray. Oh God, when nothing existed but chaos, you swept across the waters and you brought forth creation. In the days of Noah, oh God, you saved those on the ark through water. And after the flood, when you saw that your people were slaves in Egypt, you led them to freedom through the sea. Their children you brought through the Jordan to the land which you promised. In the fullness of time, O God, you sent Jesus, who was nurtured in the water of a womb, and he was baptized by John and anointed by your Spirit. He called his disciples to share in the baptism of his death and resurrection and to make disciples of all nations. And so, Lord, we pray that you would pour out the Holy Spirit to bless this gift of water and Emory Lynn Vandelicht, who receives it, to clothe her in righteousness throughout her life, that dying and being raised with Christ, she may share in his final victory. Amen. Emory Lynn Vandelicht, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. You want to lay your hands on her? Emory, the Holy Spirit work within you, that being born of water and being born of the Spirit, you may be a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ throughout your life. Amen.
Amen.
Well, church, family, this is our newest daughter and granddaughter and sister in the faith. This is Emory Lynn Vandelicht. And today, it is our joy to welcome her as part of the family. Today, along with Randy and Megan, we promise to do everything we can as she grows up to help her to come to love God and to help her to come to grow in relationship with Jesus Christ and to serve Christ in all that she does, in all that she says, and everywhere she goes. And she's doing awesome.
She did great. She did great.
Members of the household of God, I commend Emery to your love and care. Do all in your power to increase her faith, to confirm her hope, and perfect her in love. If so, you respond with the words on the screen. We give thanks for all that God has already given you, and we welcome you in Christian love. As members together with you in the body of Christ and in this congregation of the United Methodist Church, we renew our covenant faithfully to participate in the ministries of the church by our prayers, our presence, our gifts, and our service, that in everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ.
Amen. Immediately after the service, Emery and Randy and Megan will be joining us out here, either in the lobby or in the courtyard, and I invite you at that time to please offer your own personal words of congratulations. But for you, for now, will you please join with me in giving thanks to God for this holy day?
Thank you so much. Thank you, guys. It's a time which we invite all the other children to go to their own children's worship. Miss Sherry is over there by the door. I think I see Miss Katie over there. If parents, grandparents, if you've not signed your children in, please follow them out into the lobby and make sure that you take care of that. The memory verse for this sermon series continues to be Matthew 6:21. For where your treasure is, there your heart will also be. We really encourage parents and grandparents to ask your children how they're interacting with that verse. What are they learning and what's going on? Bring the experience of today back into your week with them. A few announcements this morning. The attendance card that you got, one of the ways in which you can celebrate your gift of presence is to let us know that you were here and to tear that off and to put it in the offering basket as it comes. We are in need of Easter volunteers, and that's one of the check boxes on the bottom of that card. We will have services in this sanctuary at 9 a.m., 10 a.m., and 11 a.m. on Easter, and we need folks to help us in children's ministry and throughout the church, but especially in children's ministry. If you are coming to the 9, maybe you can help at the 10, or if you're coming at 11, maybe you can help at 10, or however you would like to do that, to split that up. But that would be a wonderful gift to the church, is to not only come and worship, but then to come also and help volunteer. I want to let you know that First United Methodist Church Foundation, their scholarships are now available. If you go to our website at jcfumc.org and find the foundation, there are numerous scholarships that are available for college-age students if you and for other reasons. But for scholarship students for college, please, if you know someone that is interested in that, you can please point them to that website or call the office and we'll help connect you with that. Also, to let you know that the Stations of the Cross and some art exhibits is now in the lobby. That'll be up all the way through Easter. It's an opportunity to see a lot of different art that sort of themed around the week of Holy Week. And also different stations. You can walk through those Stations of the Cross and understand Jesus' final hours. And those who participate find it to be a very moving experience. You can come during the day, come after church, come after work. We'll try to leave the lobby open until about 7. And just please, it's a self-guided tour, and we welcome you to participate in that during this Holy Week. But for now, let us return to our scripture for this morning. We are in the Gospel according to Mark. We're in chapter 14, verses 32 through 50. They went to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to his disciples, "Sit here while I pray." He, Jesus, took with him Peter and James and John, and they began to be distressed and agitated. And he said to them, "I am deeply grieved, even to death. Remain here and keep awake." And going a little farther, he threw himself on the ground and prayed that, if it were possible, the hour might pass for him. He said, "Abba, Father, for you all things are possible. Remove this cup from me, yet not what I want, but what you want. He came and found them sleeping. And he said to Peter, Simon, are you asleep? Could you not keep awake for 1 hour? Keep awake and pray that you may not come into the time of trial. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak. And again he went away and prayed, saying the same words. And once more he came back and found them sleeping, for their eyes were very heavy, and they did not know what to say to him. He came a third time and said to them, are you still sleeping and taking your rest? Enough! The hour has come. The Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Get up. Let us be going. See, my betrayer is at hand. Immediately, while he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived, and with him there was a crowd with swords and clubs from the chief priests, the scribes, and the elders. Now the betrayer had given them a sign, saying, the one I will kiss is the man. Arrest him and lead him away under guard. So when he came, he went up to him at once and said, Rabbi, and kissed him. Then he laid hands on him and arrested him. But one of those who stood near drew his sword and struck the slave of the high priest, cutting off his ear. Then Jesus said to them, have you come out with swords and clubs to arrest me as though I were a bandit? Day after day I was with you in the temple teaching, and you did not arrest me. But let the scriptures be fulfilled. All of them deserted him and fled. My friends, this is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Good morning again. Church, you are looking good this morning. It is so wonderful to have you here. My name is Daniel Hilty, and I am one of the pastors here. I get to share in the sermon time with us this morning. And I want to say just what a blessing it is to have you here this morning. You make this worship service all the more beautiful and all the more a blessing. Especially if you are visiting with us this morning, we are really grateful to God for you. And for those of you who may be watching on the TV or on internet as well, we pray that all of us somehow have a sense of Christ this hour, of God's love for you this hour, and that in some way, in some moment, in something that happens, you have a moment of meeting Jesus this morning. We're grateful that you're here. I'd like to ask you to please join with me in a moment of prayer as we pray. Well, God, we are grateful for this morning. It is a morning of joys, of baptism, and of music, and of sun shining, and of friends we know and friends we don't know yet, of experiencing your love and grace, of singing Hosanna with the crowds. But we're aware this is also the start of a more somber week too, O Lord, as we prepare for the cross of Jesus. We pray, O Lord, that you would help us not to turn away from the harder pieces of this week as well. Help us, O Lord, to walk with Christ, the way of the cross. And assure us that Christ walks with us as well. Be in all that we sing and say and do and hear and think and feel and offer and receive this hour, that it may serve somehow to draw us closer to you and to closer to our neighbors and closer to Christ. We pray all these things through your Holy Spirit. Amen. So kind of a philosophical question to begin the sermon time today. What makes you, you? What makes you, you throughout all of the changes in your life, year after year after year? What is the one thing that remains that makes you, you? Because, you know, we are not the same people we were, right? We're not the same people we were, especially when we were children. I mean, have you ever looked at an old photograph of yourself as a child? I've had this experience. You look at an old photograph of yourself as a child, and it's like you don't even recognize that person in the picture, right? You can't even see any part of you in this younger version of you. That's kind of what we're talking about today. In so many ways, we are not the same people that we were, right? When we were children, we're not the same people we were even like a year ago or a month ago. We're always changing. We look different. We change our hairstyle. We change our clothes. We act differently. We come to believe differently. You know, we're not even made out of the same stuff as we were a year ago. Scientists say that 98% of the atoms in our bodies are replaced every year. Can you imagine that? 98% of our bodies are replaced by new atoms every year. And yet somehow I'm still going bald. I don't get that. It's like the 2% that never gets replaced is right here, right? But even though we go through all of these changes in life, it seems like there's still got to be something essential in us that remains the same. Don't you think? I mean, our experience would teach us that. There's got to be this essence that remains unchanged throughout the years, even though that essence sometimes can be really hard or maybe even impossible to identify. I mean, for example, you know, take these palm branches, right? Take these palm branches that we have decorating the sanctuary, the altar here today for Palm Sunday. You know, these palm branches that we've got, they look like palm branches, right? Today we can clearly tell that they are palm branches. But in a lot of churches, these palm branches will show up again next year. And when they do, they will have changed so much that people won't even recognize them as palm branches anymore. Instead, the palms will have turned into the ashes that Christians use on Ash Wednesday to make the mark of the cross on people's foreheads. Traditionally, the palms the churches use on Palm Sunday are dried, and then they're burned, and then they're turned into ashes to be used on Ash Wednesday the following year. So even though the ashes of Ash Wednesday and the palms of Palm Sunday look nothing like each other, in a way, it seems like they've still got to share something in common, right? Even though it's virtually impossible to recognize anything in common just by looking at them. By the way, I need to be honest with you. We don't actually do this at First United Methodist Church. We don't burn our palms and then turn them into ashes for Ash Wednesday. Nothing wrong with that, but the truth is that we buy our ashes. We buy our ashes. There's this great sale at Ashes R Us every year, and you know, we can't resist the buy one ash, get one free thing. Just these little ashes. But you... what am I talking about? You get the idea, right? You get the idea. The idea is that sometimes, I mean, sometimes things get changed so much in life. Sometimes there's so much change in life, whether in palm branches or in people, that it seems really hard, if not impossible, to figure out what the essence really is. The essence just seems to get lost in all of the changes. It's kind of like the point of my favorite American history-related joke. Actually, it's the only American history-related joke I know. Not that funny, but it's still the only one I know. As the story goes, apparently there was this man, right? This man that said he had a hammer that once belonged to George Washington. Have you heard this one before? Okay, good. So he said he's got this hammer that belongs to George Washington. And this man was very proud of the fact that he had a hammer that once belonged to George Washington. And so one day he showed it off to a friend and he said, "This hammer once belonged to George Washington." He said it just emphatically like that, right? Because that's what you say when you have a hammer that once belongs to George Washington. And his friend said, "I can't believe that hammer once belonged to George Washington because it looks so new. It doesn't look old enough to have once belonged to George Washington. But the first guy insisted, he said, no, 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 the hammer really did belong to George Washington. I mean, of course, you know, we did have to do some minor maintenance over the years, of course. We had to replace the handle a few years ago, for example. And then, you know, we had to replace the head a couple years after that. But except for those two minor changes, the rest of the hammer is totally authentic. It belonged to George Washington. But did it really, right? I mean, if you change the head and the handle of a hammer, is there any part of the original hammer left? And if we change year after year after year, if 98% of the atoms in our body are changed, and we grow into adulthood and leave behind childhood, and we make new memories and we leave behind old ones year after year after year, is there really anything left unchanged in us to make us us, right? To make you you or me me? Or are we just like, you know, palm branches turning into ash? What is the essence of who you are, of who I am? That's a question I believe all of us wrestle with sooner or later in one way or another. And I believe even Jesus did. You know, if you've been here over the last couple weeks, the last half of Lent, you know already that we've been taking a look in this series at events from the last 24 hours of Jesus' life, the last day before his death on a cross. And so even though today is Palm Sunday and we observe that and celebrate that in singing Hosanna and having palms to decorate the sanctuary, in our scripture, in our message, we continue to look at this very narrow window of time in Jesus' life, his last 24 hours. It was a time period when all sorts of people were trying to figure out who this Jesus really was. What was his essence, right? What made Jesus, Jesus? And in today's scripture reading that Keith shared with us a moment ago, we come to a point in the last 24 hours of Jesus' life when I believe even Jesus himself was trying to figure out who exactly he was. It was the night of Jesus' betrayal, and it was the night before his death. And by all indications, Jesus knew that his death was coming soon. And so what does Jesus do when he knows that his death is coming soon? Well, he does what we might expect him to do. He goes to a garden called Gethsemane and he prays. And he prays there under these olive trees that were ancient even then. And there under the trees, Jesus prays what is one of the most vulnerable prayers, one of the most honest prayers in the whole Bible. Scripture tells us that Jesus throws himself to the ground and he prayed, Abba, Father, all things are possible for you. Remove this cup from me. In other words, I don't want to die. Jesus prays. And even though, you know, even though the words aren't in scripture at that point, I believe what Jesus is really wrestling with are these questions that we're talking about this morning. Who am I, really? Jesus is wrestling with. Who am I supposed to be in this moment? And what makes me me in this moment? Am I one who turns away from the cross, or am I not? Jesus prays. Am I one who runs away from suffering, or am I not? Jesus prays. And is there any part of that little child born in a manger with all that promise and all that potential that the angel said would save the world? Is there any part of that child left in me or not? Jesus prays. And in the very next sentence, it's as if Jesus answers his own question. In the very next sentence, Jesus says, yet not what I want. Jesus says to God, but what you want, what you want. In other words, and this is kind of the central point of all of this morning. In other words, Jesus answers his question of identity with a statement of commitment. Jesus answers his question of identity with a statement of commitment. And in that moment of commitment, it is as if Jesus rediscovers who he is, and he journeys with this renewed sense of identity and purpose and confidence to his arrest and his trial and his death and his resurrection. You see, in that moment of prayer under the olive trees in that garden, Jesus teaches us what I believe is one of the most important lessons that any of us can learn about what makes you really you, or what makes me really me, what makes us really us. And that lesson is that identity grows out of commitment. Identity grows out of commitment. Jesus teaches us, maybe better than anybody else ever can, that who we are is a direct product of commitment. Here's another way to think about it. You know, the word commit actually comes from two smaller Latin words. You know, we had to have a nerdy moment in here, right? From two smaller Latin words, come, meaning together, and metere, meaning to put. So our commitments, on a root level, our commitments are literally what put us together as people. Our commitments are literally what put us together as people. They are what put together all the different parts and pieces and atoms of you and make you you, right? And make me me throughout our lives. For example, you know, if I were to ask you this morning, what's most important to know about who you are or who you really want to be? I suspect almost all of us would say something that could be traced back eventually to some sort of commitment. If we say that we are honest, for example, that's because at some point we've made a commitment to honesty. If we say that we are a good friend, for example, that is because somewhere along the lines we made a commitment to being a faithful person to the people that we love. If we say that we are a husband or a wife, that's because we made a commitment to our spouse. If we say that we are a Christian, that's because we made a commitment to God in Jesus Christ. The one thing that remains constant throughout all of the changes of life, throughout all of our changing identities, all the atoms that get swapped in and out of our lives and all the growth, the one thing that can remain constant through all of that is our commitments. Our commitments to a calling, our commitment to a person, a commitment to people, a commitment to love, a commitment to faith, to hope, a commitment to God, a commitment to Jesus. It's the one thing that doesn't change when everything else changes. But here's the catch. There's a catch. You know, this is a United Methodist Church, so there's always a catch, right? Here's the catch. The catch is that as important as our commitments are to shaping us and making us who we are, our identity still has to be based on more than just that. Because what happens sooner or later to our commitments? Do we always live up to them, ideally? No, right? No, at least I know I don't. I don't. Sooner or later, we don't. We don't live up to those virtues that we say we're committed to. We're a little bit less than honest, even though we say we're committed to honesty. Or maybe our marriage falls apart. Or maybe we drift away from God. Or we drift away from Christ. And then what happens, right? What happens to our identities, to who we really are when we don't have those commitments that have always defined us before? Well, that's when we can remember, like Jesus did, that ultimately our identity grows not just out of the commitments we make to others or to God, but also and especially God's commitment toward us. God's commitment toward us. Because God's commitment toward us never fails, never falters, never falls away. You see, above all, you are who you really are because of God. Your true identity is beloved. Your true identity is child of God. And God's commitment to you will never let you go. And so, getting back to this question that we started the sermon with today, what makes you really you? Here's the response that we can learn from Jesus in today's scripture reading. What makes you you are your commitments to others and God, and then especially God's commitment to you. No matter what else the world may tell you, No matter what else others may tell you about who they think you are, or who they think you aren't, or who they think you should be, or who they think you shouldn't be. None of that matters as much as this. The truth is this, and there's nothing more important than this. Which brings us to these bookmarks. Hopefully you got these bookmarks when you came in. If you didn't get one, could you raise your hand, please? We've got one up here. Oh, thank you. Looks like most of us. If you didn't get one, please raise your hand. And maybe if ushers, if you guys could please help to deliver some bookmarks, we'd appreciate that very much. Just, I'll keep talking, but if you don't mind just keeping your hands raised, then they will get them to you. Thank you very much. You know, these bookmarks are just a gift for you to take home and hopefully to use and to look at often. Thank you, ushers, for your help. But they're more than just something to take home, because, you know, they're also reminders of who we are, right? Now, one side, of course, you know, is blatant and unapologetic self-promotion as a church. But on the other side, on the other side is this prayer, this really old prayer by John Wesley, the founder of the Methodist Church. And it's a prayer above all that is a prayer of commitment, a prayer of our commitment to God and also of God's commitment to us. And in that commitment, we are invited to discover who we really are in God. The text of this prayer is on the bookmark, but it's also on the screen. And this morning, if you feel like maybe God is calling you to rediscover your true identity in God, or maybe you feel this morning like God is calling you for the very first time to discover who you really are in God. If you feel a nudge or a pull or a call from God, then I invite you to please take a moment to pause and to pray this prayer of commitment to God with me. Let's pray. I am no longer my own, but yours. Put me to what you will. Rank me with whom you will. Put me to doing. Put me to suffering. Let me be employed for you, or laid aside for you, exalted for you, or brought low for you. Let me be full, let me be empty, let me have all things, let me have nothing. I freely and wholeheartedly yield all things to your pleasure and disposal. And now, glorious and blessed God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, you are mine, and I am yours, so be it. And the covenant now made on earth, let it be ratified in heaven. Amen. Thank you. To close the sermon today, I'm wondering if you could please read this one line with me just a few more times as a kind of shorthand version of the commitment we just made. Could you please say this with me? Oh God, you are mine, and I am yours, so be it. My friends, this is what makes you, you. You are who you really are because you belong to God, and God belongs to you and is committed to you. And so, whatever we face in life, whenever those moments come when we feel lost or confused, and we wonder who we really are, we can pray this to God. We can pray, please say it with me again. Oh God, you are mine, and I am yours. So be it. Whenever the world tries to turn you into something that you are not, or to tell you what you should or should not be, we can pray to God, say it with me, oh God, you are mine, and I am yours, so be it. And when finally we are facing our own cross, or you are facing your own cross, or you are facing that night when it doesn't seem like the sun is ever going to rise, we can look to Jesus, who knew exactly what moments like that were all about. And we can look to heavens just like Jesus did, and with the confidence and the strength and the power of children of God and of Jesus Christ himself, we can pray this one last time. Oh God, you are mine, and I am yours. So be it. So be it. You are God's, and God is yours. And my friends, that is what makes you, you. Thanks be to God. Amen. It's now time we worship God by giving of ourselves, by responding to God's invitation in our lives, by making an offering of our lives. The ushers are going to come forward and pass the baskets. And as they do, I want to let you know, we don't expect you to give if you are visiting today. If you're visiting today, it's just a gift to have you here. But you're certainly welcome to if you feel so moved. Also, if you prefer to give by using your smartphone, you can use the laminated QR code on the back of the seat in front of you to give in that way as well. Let's worship God by giving of ourselves and offering our best to God.
Once again, I look upon the cross where you died. I'm humbled by your mercy and I'm broken inside. Once again, I thank you. Once again, I pour out my life. Jesus Christ. You became nothing, poured out to death. Many times I've wondered at your gift of life, and I'm in that place once again. I'm in that place once again.
One more time, will you please join with me giving thanks to God for what a blessing it is to have Amy leading us in worship today. We're so grateful for her. Thank you so much, Amy. You're a blessing to us. Will you please join with me in a moment of prayer? Oh God, we thank you for the cross and for this journey to it. We pray, oh Lord, that you would help us to find you, to find Jesus, to find ourselves along the way. We thank you for this opportunity to give. We pray that you would use these gifts for the work of that Savior, Jesus Christ, who gathers us together, who makes us who we are, and through whom we pray. Amen. I invite us to stand as we're able and join together as we get ready to leave. I want to invite you back for a couple of worship services coming up. First of all, our Holy Thursday, Maundy Thursday, when we remember Christ's Last Supper, is this Thursday night, 6:30 p.m., and it will be in the gym this year, 6:30 p.m. in the gym in the Christian Life Center. We're going to have communion in the round. It should be a very meaningful and beautiful experience. And then please come back next Sunday and Saturday for our Easter worship services. We've got four. We're throwing in an extra one next weekend. 6 p.m. Saturday, 9 a.m. Sunday morning, and then an extra 10 a.m. Sunday morning, and then at 11 a.m. as well. Our 9 and our 10 a.m. will both be more contemporary in format, our 11 more traditional. Hope to see you at all of these worship experiences. For now, let us go forth in peace to observe a holy Lent. Let us go forth in peace to know that you belong to Christ, Christ belongs to you, and we are who we are as a result. Go forth in peace and know that God goes with you this day and always.